Yes, the topic, as Alison indicated, is operationalising political economy analysis for development. The first point I need to make is that in recent years there has been increasing interest within the donor community in understanding the way in which political economy factors shape development outcomes. And they've invested a significant amount of resources in research projects aimed at trying to elucidate the role of politics in shaping development outcomes, reflecting, I think, a number of, or two key imperatives. The first is the aid effectiveness imperative. During the Cold War, aid was driven largely by geostrategic and political imperatives. With the end of the Cold War, those imperatives have remained significant, but there's been increased attention on using aid to achieve development-related objectives, in particular objectives related to poverty reduction and sustainable development. At the same time, there have been a number of academic studies, particularly during the late 90s and early 2000s, that have suggested that aid hasn't been terribly effective in promoting things like economic growth or social development or improved governance or policy change. The donor literature itself, you know, reports, accountability-type reports that donor agencies prepare for parliaments, for their own governments, have typically painted a fairly rosy picture of aid's effectiveness, but the academic literature hasn't backed that up at all. And that's placed a degree of pressure on donors to try and lift their game in terms of aid effectiveness. And so they've been casting around for ideas to different strategies to try and change the way in which they manage and deliver and allocate aid. And that's provided a space for increased use of political economy analysis. The second thing that's gone on here that's served to increase donor interest in the role of politics in shaping development outcomes has been that there's been growing recognition within the donor community that top-down technocratic approaches to development simply don't work terribly well, and that aid is most likely to be effective where donors have a good understanding of the sort of political, social and cultural environment in which they're operating. Very often that's captured in the notion of country ownership, which has become a key buzzword in development policy circles since at least the mid-90s, and which is a concept that's enshrined in the key international policy document governing aid effectiveness, the Paris Declaration on Aid Effectiveness, where country ownership is listed as one of five key principles of aid effectiveness. And in fact, it's the first principle that's listed and seems to have a higher priority as a result. There are a number of examples that I can point to of research projects that donors have invested in to try and improve their understanding of the role of politics in shaping development outcomes. Perhaps the best known is the UK Department for International Development, or DFID's Drivers of Change research program, which began in the late 90s, early 2000s, and involved the commissioning of a series of studies looking at quote-unquote drivers of change within the various countries on which those studies focused. The Swedish aid agency, CEDA, has commissioned a series of studies that it calls power analyses, and they've had similar sorts of objectives. The Netherlands Ministry of Foreign Affairs, which runs that country's aid program, has commissioned a series of strategic governance and corruption analyses. AusAid recently has set up this program called the Developmental Leadership Program. It's in fact a joint effort with a number of other donors and some NGOs, but as I understand it, AusAid's the key funder of that program. The purpose of the Developmental Leadership Program is to, like these other programs, explore the role of politics in shaping development outcomes, but with a particular focus on the role of agency. The starting point for that research program is the idea that political economy analysis on development issues has tended to focus on institutional or structural variables and not given enough attention to the role of agency. And so this research project is aimed at trying to tease out the role of agency in particular. The World Bank has also been involved in this sort of terrain, although perhaps a bit less centrally than some of the bilateral donors. And their main vehicle for exploring these sorts of ideas has been their so-called governance assessments. So a number of donors have been involved in this whole area, and a significant amount of resources has been invested. A small amount compared to overall aid budgets, but nevertheless, some substantial resources have been invested. But while donors have commissioned a lot of work looking at the role of politics in shaping development, they've made relatively little progress in operationalising the findings of that research, of translating the findings of that research into policy design and implementation. And there have been some good political reasons why that's been the case. The first is that in asserting the primacy of politics in shaping development outcomes, political economy analysis has threatened the privileged position of technocrats within aid bureaucracies. And by referring to technocrats here, I'm not just talking about economists, but really anyone with sort of technical professional expertise, anyone whose tendency might be to see aid effectiveness in terms of the quality of technical inputs or the quality of management processes surrounding aid activities rather than in terms of political and social factors. And as many of you would be aware, I mean, it's precisely those technocratic types that really dominate the development sector. So political economy analysis has presented something of a threat to these sorts of individuals. A second reason why there's been relatively limited progress in terms of operationalising the findings of political economy analysis has been that it's forced donor agencies and the governments that run them to admit to the political nature of aid. And that's something that donors have always been very uncomfortable to admit. It's something they've quite deliberately tried to hide. I remember, for instance, reading World Bank documents on good governance that made a very explicit point of stressing the technical nature of the good governance agenda and saying that it simply wasn't political at all in nature. So donors themselves have been very uncomfortable about admitting the political nature of what they do. And yet political economy analysis effectively asks them or effectively forces them to see themselves as political actors pursuing a particular set of interests and a particular agenda. A third factor here that stood in the way of operationalising political economy analysis has been that thinking and operating politically implies a degree of intervention in developing countries that aid recipient countries may not be willing to countenance. And so there's potential there for opposition or resistance to the use of political economy analysis on the part of aid recipient countries themselves, who may feel that if donors are operating in a more strategic political manner, then that's a potential breach of their sovereignty. So that's a third, a third political factor that's stood in the way of the operationalisation of political economy analysis. But at the same time, I think the fact that political economy analysis hasn't been operationalised within many donor organisations reflects the fact that donor organisations themselves haven't really done much thinking about how they might go about operationalising the findings of this analysis. If one looks at the sorts of research projects or research programs that I mentioned earlier, the drivers of change, developmental leadership program, and what have you, the emphasis has been very much on trying to establish an evidence base for the idea that politics matters. The focus has been on trying to produce the evidence to support the case that donors need to give greater attention to the role of politics in shaping development. Relatively little attention has been given to the question of what donors actually do with the research. Typically, the studies that have been commissioned through these sorts of research programs has required the authors of the research to outline the operational implications of their research in the conclusion. But what you've ended up with is a set of quite disjointed sets of recommendations. You know, a paper on Malawi might specify one set of recommendations, a paper on Indonesia another set, and what have you. And those sets of recommendations might be contradictory. They might be very hard to really join up. So the donor community itself hasn't done a great amount to really think about how it moves this agenda forward. That, fortunately, I think, is beginning to change. And what I'm going to concentrate on in today's presentation is one attempt to try and specify how a particular aid agency, in this case the World Bank, should seek to implement or operationalise political economy analysis, how it should make use of it in the day-to-day operations of the bank. There have in fact been a number of papers written recently, not many. I've only been able to identify three or four, but there have been a number of papers that have dealt now with this issue of operationalisation. So I think there has been a shift in the nature of the discussion going on that's quite significant. And the report that I'll concentrate on here, the one on the World Bank, is, I think, far and away the most significant of the various things that have been written so far, in part because it's the most detailed. The report's a reasonably lengthy one. And it's also the one that is perhaps clearest in terms of what donors should do. In this case, as I said, the World Bank. The report that I'm referring to is called Problem-Driven Governance and Political Economy Analysis, Good Practice Framework, and it was published by the World Bank in 2009. It's authored not by the World Bank itself, but by three people who I believe are staff members of the bank, Verena Fritz, Kai Kaiser, and Brian Levi. So let me move beyond these introductory comments. What I'm going to do now is try to specify a framework for evaluation of this particular report. I'll then move on to talk about the report itself and the approach to operationalising political economy analysis that's outlined in that report. I'll then give an evaluation of that report in terms of the framework that I specified at the beginning, and then I'll conclude with some comments about where I think this agenda is likely to go in coming years. So let me move on now to the framework for evaluation. I think the first point I need to make in this respect is that operationalising political economy analysis within donor agencies is not something that is a straightforward matter. There are a number of key choices or decisions that need to be made in order to operationalise this analysis. The first is which analytical framework to use, or which theoretical framework to use. Comparative political economy, which is the sort of terrain, the sort of field that is being covered or within which political economy analysis carried out by donors is located. It's a very rich field with a long history, and it's a field that's been characterised by quite intensive debate between different theoretical camps. You've got Marxist political economists on the one hand emphasising the role of class factors and the role of the state in pursuing particular class agendas. You've got institutionalist political economies drawing on, in particular, rational choice, institutionalist ideas, the sort of ideas associated with Douglas North, the economic historian. Institutionalists also draw a lot on the Weberian tradition, notions of patrimonialism, legal rational authority, that sort of thing. You've got a liberal pluralist tradition within political economy as well that emphasises the role of individuals in engaging in collective action around particular political agendas, and also the role of individual leaders in exercising their autonomy. There's a big focus on the role of elites within the liberal pluralist tradition. You've also got a post-structuralist tradition within comparative political economy as well that emphasises the role of discourse in shaping development outcomes. So, you know, there's quite a rich field there, and in operationalising political economy analysis within donor organisations, a decision has to be made about, you know, where you locate your analysis in theoretical terms. The second key decision that has to be made relates to when political economy analysis gets used. You know, is it something that you make compulsory? Is it something that you require aid officials to do at every stage in the decision-making process and at every level in the decision-making process? Is it something that gets built into just country strategies? Is it something that you might also use at the project level? Or is that too low a level of decision-making to really bother with political economy analysis? So, you know, there are decisions to be made there about when the analysis is most appropriately used. There are also a set of decisions that need to be taken that have some bearing on donor relationships with aid recipient countries. One is, will the analysis be carried out jointly with partner country governments or independently by donors? Is this something that donors just go and do on their own? Or do they try to engage partner country governments and other actors, for that matter, within aid recipient countries in carrying out this analysis and employing it in decision-making processes? Or do donors just go off and do this on their own? Will the results of the analysis be made public or not? As you'd all be aware, I'm sure, foreign affairs officials located in foreign embassies do political analysis, write cables, send them back home, provide advice to foreign ministers that deal with political issues and what have you. So that's all done essentially undercover. Now, do donors take the same approach, or do they publish the findings of the political economy analysis that they commission or prepare themselves? So that's another decision that needs to be made. Finally, decisions have to be made about how this type of analysis, how this political economy analysis gets translated into action. And in that respect, a key issue is how donors deal with the sovereignty issue. If political economy analysis, if the implication of political economy analysis is that there is significant scope for a donor through a particular type of intervention or set of interventions to change key features of an aid recipient country, key political features, key administrative features, at what point do you rule out those sorts of interventions? At what point do they start to breach sovereignty? At what point are they illegitimate? Those sorts of issues need to be built into some sort of operational plan for implementing political economy analysis. So, bearing all those things in mind, what I have developed is a framework for evaluation that centres on three main questions. The first is the proposed analytical framework to be employed in the political economy analysis intellectually coherent and defensible? And in that respect, a key issue is how does the analysis, how does the framework for analysis employed by the donor relate to those key traditions in political economy that I mentioned earlier? A second key question is, will political economy analysis be employed when it's required to enhance aid effectiveness? And the key issue here is, to what extent do donors go down the path of mainstreaming, as they have with gender analysis, for instance? Or alternatively, do donors make political economy analysis something that's essentially optional for aid managers? The third key question is the proposed approach itself politically feasible? You know, given the type of resistance, the potential for opposition to the use and operationalisation of this analysis that I mentioned earlier, will it be accepted by aid bureaucrats, politicians, recipient country governments and others who might potentially object to its use? So they're the three questions that form the basis for the framework and for the evaluation of the bank's approach to political economy analysis that I'll turn to now. So what I'll do here is I'll give you a quick overview of the bank's approach to political economy analysis, which, as I think I indicated earlier, they refer to as problem-driven governance and political economy analysis. And then I'll present an evaluation of that of their approach, drawing on the framework that I've just mentioned. The first point I need to make, though, just before mapping out the nature of the bank's approach, is that this is awkward terrain for the World Bank. And it's awkward terrain for the bank for two main reasons. The first is that the bank's articles of association explicitly prohibit the bank from engaging in political activity. I'll just read to you the relevant paragraph of the articles of association. It says, "The bank and its officers shall not interfere in the political affairs of any member, nor shall they be influenced in their decisions by the political character of the member or members concerned. Only economic considerations shall be relevant to their decisions, and these considerations shall be weighed impartially in order to achieve the purposes of the bank." So, you know, there's an explicit prohibition there for the bank in relation to getting involved in political affairs. They're meant to stick to economic stuff. Now, Fritz, Kaiser and Levy in the report that I'm looking at here deal with this issue by stating in a short sentence that's tucked away in a footnote that, and I'll quote it to you. They say, "While the World Bank's mandate explicitly precludes it from engaging in politics, it's become widely accepted that the institution needs to understand the political economy context of reforms from a diagnostic perspective in order to be able to assist countries effectively in designing and implementing development strategies and policies." So the bank needs to, you know, it's basically key to the aid effectiveness agenda, and at the end of the day it's about assisting developing countries themselves. So that's the way in which they've sought to deal with that rather awkward issue. The second reason why this whole terrain is fairly awkward for the bank is that political economy analysis has tended to be fairly critical of the sort of neoliberal agenda that the World Bank has promoted in developing countries over the past few decades. It hasn't always been critical. There's a there's a tradition of neoclassical political economy analysis, which is tended to be sympathetic towards the sort of agenda pursued by the bank. But a lot of it has been critical. And certainly the sort of individuals who have been involved in the commissioned research projects that I mentioned earlier have tended to come from that more critical camp, in large part because this agenda, I think, has been driven out of the UK and Western Europe, where political economy analysis has tended to be in the Marxist and institutionalist camps that have traditionally been more critical of neoliberal approaches. And in particular, political economy analysis has emphasised the contested nature of neoliberal reform. Rather than seeing neoliberal reform as something that's just self-evidently right, that's technically correct, that is the obvious way to go in order to promote growth and poverty reduction, political economy analysis has tended to see neoliberalism as a particular political agenda. And in that respect, it's raised questions about the interests that the bank represents. Very often in political economy analysis, the neoliberal agenda of the bank is counterposed to populist or redistributive agendas that subordinate classes, peasants, workers, or the poor are pursuing. So they're very common in political economy analysis for the interests of the bank to be seen as contradictory to those of the poor, whom, given the bank's expressed commitment to a world free of poverty, is the community it's meant to be serving. Now, it's not clear from looking through the Fritz et al. Report exactly how the bank is going to try to deal with that particular issue. I would guess, and it's only a guess, that the bank will, if it gets serious about commissioning and using political economy analysis, tend to privilege scholars operating from traditions within political economy that are sympathetic towards the bank's work in commissioning the analysis in the first place. My guess would be that would be their approach, but that's just speculation. All right, let me map out for you the key features of the approach to operationalising political economy analysis specified in this report by Fritz et al. The first point to make, key feature is that the authors of the report acknowledge that governance and political economy analysis is something that's potentially useful for the bank. The first line of the executive summary reads, "Governance and political economy analysis has a crucial part to play in enhancing the effectiveness of development." And then a little later on it says, "This framework takes the general view that in order to improve development effectiveness, governance and political economy diagnostics should become integral to preparing and implementing bank strategies and operations." So they say, effectively, this is something that's really useful, and the bank ought to make widespread use of it in carrying out its work. It doesn't go to the point, mind you, of saying that this is something that should be mainstreamed throughout the organisation. In contrast to things like gender analysis and environmental analysis. And I think I'll hopefully get to talk about this a little bit later, but there's a contradiction. There's a contradiction there. The second key feature of the approach outlined by Fritz et al. Is that there are three layers of problem-driven governance and political economy analysis, and here I'll refer you to the diagram headed Figure 1, which is reproduced from the report. What that diagram shows is that basically, as far as Fritz and colleagues are concerned, the starting point for operationalising political economy analysis is to specify a problem that it's believed has political economy roots. So you need a problem. The starting point is the problem. And that's why they refer to their approach as problem-driven political economy analysis. And that problem might, you know, exist at a number of different levels. But the important point is that you start with the problem. The second step is to then look at the institutional and governance arrangements and capacities that surround that particular problem or that relate to that particular problem. And this, as the slide indicates, might involve things like the mapping of relevant branches of government, ministries, agencies, state-owned enterprises and their interaction, existing laws and regulations and so on. So the idea is to try and map out the basic institutional environment within which this problem is located. These two elements are essentially represent, I think, the way in which the bank has traditionally gone about doing governance assessments. Because of that historical concern about avoiding engagement with political issues, when the bank has dealt with, at least until recently anyway, when the bank has dealt with governance-related issues, it's tended to stick to those two, those two dimensions: a specification of a problem, which might be, you know, the lack of reform in a particular area, and then a mapping out of the institutional environment, and in particular the what the bank would see as the absences of key types of capacity in particular parts of the government. If there might be a discussion of corruption within that particular context, but it would tend to be a fairly depoliticised assessment of corruption, one that sees corruption as essentially stemming from institutional weaknesses and moral weaknesses on the part of individual bureaucrats or politicians, rather than being something that is a larger reflection of the structure of power and interest within society. The new element for the bank, and this is the third layer of analysis, is what is called in the report and in that diagram, the political economy drivers. And there the idea is to focus on the issue of why the problem has materialised in the first place, why there are institutional gaps or weaknesses. And this is an element of the analysis that requires the bank to look at things like the interests of stakeholders, the incentives that they face, questions of rents and rent distribution, historical legacies, and so on. It brings in particular the sort of factors that political economists writing on development have tended to emphasise in their own work, particularly in the more critical traditions. The third key feature of the bank's approach relates to levels of analysis. The bank says that problem-driven political economy analysis is something that can be used, indeed should be used, not just for very high-level decision-making, not just when the bank is formulating country strategies, for instance, but also when it's designing projects, also when it's developing sector strategies, or thematic strategies, say strategies in relation to gender or governance, or the environment. So it's something that operates at, or should operate at, a number of different levels in terms of the bank's decision-making. The fourth key feature, and this relates to the diagram that's headed figure 4, three clusters of drivers, is that the bank has a fairly, a fairly laissez-faire or eclectic approach to the sorts of explanatory variables that it is interested in researching and understanding through political economy analysis. And it groups them into three main brackets there. structural variables, institutional variables, and actors and stakeholders. There's a bit of a history to this diagram. It's the basic framework that was used and developed by a DFID when it initiated the drivers of change studies. And the banks more or less adopted that same framework. The final feature that I'll mention of the approach outlined in this report relates to the translation of problem-driven governance and political economy analysis into action. What the report says is that there are essentially three ways in which the bank can make use of political economy analysis. The first is as a basis for adjusting bank strategies and operations to an existing space for change. So, I mean, essentially what they're saying here is that political economy analysis can point you to key areas of intervention where the opportunities for progress in terms of the bank's agenda, poverty reduction and policy agenda, are likely to be greatest. It can point to areas where political opposition is likely to be so intense that the bank's just not likely to achieve anything, and direct the bank towards areas where progress is more likely to occur. The second thing it says is that political economy analysis can serve to enhance and broaden policy dialogue and develop innovative approaches to operations. So essentially, what they're saying here is that the analysis can serve as a basis for generating more informed discussion around key reform issues within an aid recipient country. And the final way in which political economy analysis can be translated into action is that it can serve as a basis for developing support for proactive campaigns for change through, and I'm quoting here from a particular part of the report, through coalition building, information and communication campaigns, and generally intensified work with stakeholders on both the supply and demand side. This bit's quite significant because here the report is envisaging the bank playing a role in actually trying to quite deliberately promote change within developing countries using political economy analysis as the basis for the strategy that is pursued. All right, let me try and present relatively quickly my evaluation of this approach, drawing on those three key questions or issues that I mentioned earlier. The first of those questions was, is the proposed analytical framework intellectually coherent and defensible? And I think the answer here is yes but no. It's intellectually coherent and defensible to the extent that those three key clusters of drivers that form the focus in terms of explanatory variables in the framework do relate more or less to key traditions in political economy. There's a basis in the literature. There's a basis in theory for focusing on those sorts of variables. The problem with the approach is that it's very, very eclectic. It doesn't provide any indication as to which set of variables should have analytical primacy. It basically says there are this whole array of factors that might shape development outcomes, a whole array of political factors that might shape development outcomes, but doesn't indicate which are most important. And it seems to me that a key feature of theory building within any sort of discipline is to be able to provide some sort of hierarchy of explanatory variables. That said, of course, it's notable that in the framework there's no mention of class. So class as an explanatory variable seems to be explicitly excluded, The tradition of structuralist political economy has emerged out of Marxism, and class has been a central analytical category within that tradition. But class doesn't feature on the list of variables associated with the structural category in that particular list. Structural is seen as being about whether a country's landlocked or not, whether it's got natural resources or not. It's those sorts of things, but class doesn't get a Guernsey. Okay, the second key question, will political economy analysis be employed when it's required to enhance aid effectiveness? Now, in this respect, you know, I think the fact that the report says, look, political economy analysis can be potentially useful at a whole variety of different levels, the country level, the sector or thematic level, the project or policy level, that's a good thing. And it's consistent with the political economy literature on development, which has suggested that political factors shape not only national level or macro level outcomes, but they can also shape the way in which individual development projects work over time. So, I think that's essentially a good thing, and is consistent with the idea that mainstream use of political economy analysis is most likely to enhance its effectiveness in terms of promoting aid effectiveness. But at the same time, as I mentioned earlier, the report does stop short of actually calling explicitly for the mainstream use of political economy analysis. I mean, essentially, what the report does is leave it up to individual aid managers within the bank as to whether or not they make use of political economy analysis. It's not compulsory in any respect, and in that sense, as I've already said, it's quite different to gender analysis or environmental analysis. The third issue or question associated with the framework that I specified at the beginning was, is the proposed approach politically feasible? Is this something, the ideas mapped out in this report, are they something that are likely to work at the end of the day in terms of the politics of political economy analysis itself? And I think the answer to that is yes, the approach is politically feasible, but it's politically feasible mainly because it leaves aid managers with more or less full discretion over whether or not they use the analysis in the first place and how they make use of it. So they can decide not to go ahead with it. If the aid manager himself or herself doesn't think there's much value in political economy analysis, they can just decide not to do it. If it looks likely that there might be resistance to the use of political economy analysis, be it from others within the agency or from political figures, then they can just decide not to go ahead with it. So in a way, the report doesn't really propose any significant changes to existing practice, because existing practice is essentially for political economy analysis to be employed within donor agencies on a haphazard basis. It's essentially down to the individual aid manager and what value they see in the analysis. All right, just to conclude, I'll say make a couple of points about where this whole agenda is likely to lead, if anywhere. I think there are good reasons to be pessimistic about the future of political economy analysis within donor organisations for the sorts of reasons that I've mentioned. And good reasons to be pessimistic about the future of political economy analysis within the World Bank in particular. Indeed, some key proponents of political economy analysis, and I'm thinking here in particular of Sue Unsworth, the head, former head governance person at DFID, one of the key proponents of the drivers of change work. She's expressed some concern in a number of different formats that political economy analysis may just be another passing fad or fashion within development, and God knows there have been plenty of them over the history of development. And I think, you know, there are good reasons to agree with the sort of view that she's expressed. At the same time, though, I think there are a couple of factors that suggest that this whole issue won't go away quite so easily in the future. The first reason is that the cat is effectively out of the bag. I mean, within the donor community itself, there is broad consensus that politics matters. Donors have signed up to that basic idea. And there is a substantial evidence base there, now developed over several decades, to support that particular view. And they've also, of course, with reports like the one that I've just talked about, started to broach the topic of how donors make use of this this particular form of analysis. So, you know, the cat's out of the bag, and it's very, very hard to put the cat back into the bag, I think, now that it's out. Another factor here is that the ideological climate has changed over the past decade or so in a way that makes it much, much easier to talk about the role of politics in development. A couple of years ago, at the height of the global financial crisis, Gordon Brown, then Prime Minister of the UK, declared that the Washington consensus was dead. I don't really agree with that. I think the Washington consensus is alive and well, but it's perhaps a little more tamed than it was. For that reason, there is increased scope to talk, particularly within the development sector, about the role of politics and social factors and cultural factors and what have you in the development process. The final factor, I think, that works in favour of the political economy analysis agenda is that you know, donors are likely, over the foreseeable future, to remain under pressure to improve aid effectiveness. The Paris Declaration, which I mentioned earlier, was adopted in 2005. A set of targets were set in that document to be achieved by 2010. The final assessments of progress against those targets are just being done now, but in all likelihood, the results of the assessments, and it's the OECD that's carrying out these assessments, the results of those assessments are likely to indicate that there's still plenty of scope for improvement in relation to key factors like ownership and alignment and the other key principles that are covered in the Paris Declaration. So, you know, I think the aid effectiveness agenda is going to continue, and as part of that, there's going to continue to be a search on for strategies for donors to enhance aid effectiveness. And I will conclude on that point.